of Information Act, you would post the agenda on a bulletin board. That requirement still exists under the law. The law is clear that to have a meeting, absent exigent circumstances, which I believe we have and we'll discuss in a second, the law is clear you must give 24-hour notice. Chairman of Justice and Public Safety Tommy Newell, and learning about possible criminal activity, noticed this meeting with more than 24 hours with the assistance of the Clerk of Council's office yesterday. That notice was published on the bulletin board, where it always is. And more importantly, because the Freedom of Information Act is about transparency, it was made known on the World Wide Web and every other source distributed as it always is. Thus, it was a properly noticed meeting. In fact, it was very specific in what it was noticing, which is even more transparent. The supervisor claims that because yesterday was a holiday and you couldn't see the bulletin board, that it was not a properly noticed meeting. That is false. If that legal reasoning prevailed, and I think I have a record on the Freedom of Information Act, if that legal reasoning prevailed, you could never notice a meeting on a Sunday or a Saturday. And our council, who meets typically on Mondays, would always have to notice problems at least by Friday, effectively a 72-hour notice requirement. So all who are listening, please understand, this was an appropriately noticed meeting. Nevertheless, I will make a second motion, and that is for two-thirds of this body to say that there is an exigent circumstance for a discussion of the items listed based on the prevention of future misconduct in office and criminal misappropriation of funds. So I would move that this council go on record that we believe, even if the antiquated billboard issue were to be taken up by the supervisor, that two-thirds of us believe there is nevertheless exigent circumstance to have this meeting nonetheless, and I would make that motion at this point.
Thank you. Okay, we'll take the second motion. Do we have a second?
Second. For that?
We do have a second. Is there any discussion on the second motion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries.
Mr. Chairman, please note that that passed unanimously, which meets the two-third requirement.
It is so noted. Is there any other discussion on the first motion to enter into executive session? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries unanimously. Folks, we'll be back as soon as we can. Thank you. Mr. Williams, will you report us out of executive session, please?
Council went to executive session for the reasons stated in the motion. No action was taken.
Thank you, sir. Before we adjourn, I would like to get the floor to Councilman Whitley. Councilman.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chairman. Prior to coming into this meeting, the members of this body were threatened with a lawsuit by Deputy Supervisor Timothy Callanan. I, for one, am not scared. I have a record regarding frivolous lawsuits. On Friday, it was brought to my attention that Supervisor Piegler ordered the Director of Finance to write a check to Timothy Callanan for $49,900 and ordered the director of finance that if he told anyone or his staff told anyone, and in particular told counsel and Josh Whitley, that they would be terminated. I immediately notified members of counsel that I had come with this information, and we legally called this meeting today. Mr. Callanan was also placed on administrative leave effective Friday with that payment of check, effective till December the 3rd, so that he could have benefits through the end of the fiscal year. The supervisor directed payroll that the source of funds for this check would be the future salary of the next supervisor's deputy supervisor, effectively limiting Mr. Cribb from hiring a deputy supervisor. Further, he told the director of finance that this was authorized by counsel in executive session. Members of the public, counsel cannot take any action in executive session. There was no authorization to pay Mr. Callanan $49,900. The basis of payment, according to what we've been advised, is for a severance agreement. Severance agreements are not permitted under South Carolina law. Mr. Callanan has threatened us that severance agreement contains a non-disparagement clause, and he would sue counsel or take legal action if I came out here or anyone to disparage him. I expect members of the public to be at the courthouse with me to defend the public's right to know and to defend when councilmen have been threatened by frivolity. Mr. Callanan required that check be given to him in person and immediately took it to the county's bank and cashed it so that counsel or anyone could not do any sort of stop payment. We will hear later in the Committee on Justice and Public Safety what counsel is going to do about those facts. But I want members of the public to know that this council is committed to transparency. And today, our PIO couldn't be more neutral. Was told to put out a press release about this that she disagreed with. Mr. Piegler placed her on administrative leave without pay and threatened to fire her. What I would tell the members of our staff, most importantly, in the next 8 weeks of this administration, if you are threatened with your job, go home. Enjoy the vacation, and we'll make it right as a council. Hannah, the PIO, did exactly right today. And this council recognizes that. I am sorry the position that the staff, that the finance staff has been put in. I'm sorry the position council's been put in. I'm sorry the position the public's been put in. But council does believe these acts require a SLED investigation, and we will ask for one later this evening, as well as take up a vote on the termination effective immediately of the deputy supervisor. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilman. I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move.
We have a motion. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We adjourn. Thank you. Thank you.
I would like to call the Human Resources and Purchasing meeting to order. At this time, I would like to ask Councilman Pinckney to provide the invocation for us and Councilman Newell to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
Let us pray. Our God and our Father, it's again we come and we tell you thank you for allowing us to come together once again. We ask that you come and be within our midst. And, oh God, lead, guide, and direct us throughout this night. Help us as a governing body, oh God, to make right decisions, do the right thing for the betterment of your people. Help us, oh God. Give us the moral authority that we need, that we would make decisions that would promote social, economic, racial justice for all. Keep us mindful that we are to be good stewards, that we are to be good gatekeepers, that we are to watch as well as pray. Help us to be good public servants. Keep us mindful that there will come a day of accountability. So help us to do your will in all that we do here tonight. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, and liberty and justice for all.
Next, in celebration of Veterans Day, a significant Veterans Day in that this year was the 100th anniversary of the ending of World War I. This is the meeting closest to that holiday. Let us not forget those who have served before us, sacrificed to provide us with what we have today and enjoy. Thank you, veterans. Madam Clerk of Council, has this meeting been properly noted via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you. First on the agenda, we have the approval of minutes from the regular committee meeting held on October 8th, 2018.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Are there any corrections to these minutes? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The minutes stand approved as presented. Item number one on the agenda is the video conferencing proposal for bond court. Chief Magistrate, Ms. Ellen.
Mr. Chairman, Judge Karish couldn't be here tonight. I'm Paula Shank. I'm the director for the summary court. Our request tonight is not for funding, but for the council's approval for video conferencing. The Supreme Court does require county council's approval of the proposal before we can submit it to them. A copy of the proposal was attached with the agenda that we sent in, the request to be on the agenda tonight.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is item two, IFB 21003-02-1819, roof replacement for the Goose Creek Senior Center.
Move for approval.
Second.
Okay. Mr. Fosnight, does anybody have any questions of him? Seeing none, I have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Next is item three, IFB 21003-01-1819, roof replacement for the Canehoy Community Center.
Move for approval.
Second.
Any discussion? Questions?
What's the amount?
Dollar amount, sir?
$38,750.
Funding source?
It's partial insurance reimbursement and partial FEMA funding.
Good. Okay.
Thank you.
Any further? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Thank you. Item number four is RFP 35001-01-1819, dirt to pave, pavement of five roads. Lisa? I don't look like Lisa.
No, sir. But I've asked.
Got a hormone problem.
Ms. Costner is ill, so she's not going to be here. But I've asked Danny Thrower and Lisa Villapanto from our, who's our contracts administrator, to speak to this issue.
Okay.
I want Danny to talk.
Mr. Chairman and members of committee, RFP 35001-01-1819, dirt to pave for five roads, was sent out and closed on August 28th. Evaluation committee was formed to review seven proposals that were submitted. Based on the evaluation tabulation form criteria, the submitted proposals were shortlisted to the three contractors. Upon a presentation by the three contractors and questionnaire by the committee, it was determined that a recommendation for awarding the contract should go to Banks Construction in the amount of $2,189,000 to $724 with 270-day completion date from the start.
And what five roads are those?
It is Starks Croker, Coaxum Road, Timberline Way, Jacob Pilot.
Move for approval.
And Falling.
And what's the last one?
Falling Road.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Yep, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Sherlock.
Thank you. Danny, on Coaxum Road, is that right away? I know that was being held up with some right away issues. Everything's clear now.
Everything
as far as right away.
Yes, sir. All the right aways have been acquired and cleared out.
I know JDM and them will really appreciate that. Right. Thank you for that.
That was actually on the first 1 cent sales tax, these roads, so we're...
Yeah, they've been waiting a while, so I know they'll really appreciate it, but I'll call them tonight.
And we'd be glad to take them off our maintenance list, too, so I'm looking forward to
it. Of course. That's right. Thank you.
And, Mr. Chairman, I just want to highlight that the folks on Coaxum Road have been waiting for some period of time, and we welcome this news. I had promised they thought we would not deliver, so thank you, thank you, thank you again.
Yes, sir.
Was that a second, Mr. Schulnight?
Did you second it?
Yes, second that.
I have a motion and second. Any further discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Pinckney?
Yes, Mr. Thrower.
Yes, sir.
Got a concern about Poplar Hill Drive. I called, but I didn't get any response to it. They came out and they paved a portion of it. And that road is in very deplorable condition. Can you give me an update as to what we should expect going forward? Because I don't have an answer for the folks out there.
Right. I'm going to have to check in that, sir. I need to talk with some people about who's handling that project and overseeing that project, but I'll be happy to get the information back to you.
Because they pave a very short portion of it, and it's just an accident waiting to happen.
Yes, sir.
I'd really appreciate an update on that.
I will definitely get back to you as soon as
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Whitley.
Mr. Blankenship or Ms. Villaponte, this might be for y'all. Was there something awry with this bid? I heard tell that the contractor was low bid, and then we went back to him and suggested we may do something else. Could they change their price, or was this a straightforward process, or can you enlighten me on that?
It was an RFP. Once we determined the three shortlisted companies, we did bring them in. A couple of them made adjustments to their bids, but this was still the low bid from the get-go. This was the lowest bidder from the get-go.
What was told to me, and I don't know right or wrong, Lisa, but was that the contractor was brought back in, and as we all know, with this area booming, the low bidder was not happy that it was being manipulated as such, and he said, I just won't bid in Berkeley County anymore if we're not going to do it straightforward, low bid wins and goes home. And the point was, we don't need to lose anybody, particularly a major guy, because our prices will increase if we lose bidders. So I just want to make sure, was there a reason we went back to him, or? Les, do you know the issue? Y'all can get with me online. It still went to the low bidder. I want that. I mean, that's fine with me, but I just want to make sure we're not, for some off reason, making our pool of bidders smaller, because that we will pay for it in the long run.
Yes, sir. Mr. Whitley, I'm not aware of any particular issue with this particular RFP. I will say that we went from a low bid system for bidding out these types of construction projects to an RFP so that we could then go back and negotiate where appropriate, value engineer some things. And
but we did that after we put it out to the public.
Correct.
And invited the bids.
That's right.
And that's, I think, a problem.
Okay. Let me check into the actual. I wasn't on the RFP committee, which I don't sit on those typically.
And I can be educated, and they could be wrong, but just look into that for me.
Yes, sir, I will.
Thank you.
Any further? I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Item number 5, BVB, Berkeley County Water and Sanitation, 11-17/18, Wooden Yard Debris.
For approval.
For Solid Waste Division. I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item number 6, replacement for EHO-42 mini excavator. Mr. Blankenship.
Mr. Chairman, we would ask that we table this. We're not quite ready to bring it to council yet. We want to see if we can get some more quotes.
All right. Thank you. We will table that and wait for you to bring it back. Last item on the agenda is a follow-up on two questions in the last meeting with regard to the Food Line project that were asked. The length of the bond issue was asked. Well, we weren't certain at that time. What is the length of the bond issue?
Based on we received a fairly lengthy email describing the all the restrictions and the requirements for how do you spend the money and what the federal requirements are on that bond. And it typically is that the expectation is you'll spend 85% of the bond issue within 3 years.
Okay, 3 years. All right. That was the question that I had. The other question was the amount that had been expended so far, understanding that some of that money will be used properly, but we wanted to know an amount of money that had been spent so far on the project before it was halted.
Yes, sir. I believe the last council meeting that you asked the question, I gave you an estimate. That estimate was off.
Yes, sir.
The actual to date expense on the food line renovation project is $385,834.07.
Okay.
That was for design and engineering services.
So that's the amount, to clarify, that's the amount that has been expended so far. However, some of that, or maybe all of it or whatever, will be used in the process as we go along.
Yes, sir. I think that the intent is, we're revisiting the project. We're going to take a look at the design elements, particularly for the interior arrangement and what spaces are needed for what departments. There's going to be quite a bit of this design that I think we can still maintain. There are elements of, you know, structural elements, site improvements, roof type improvements to the property that we should have no problem using. So I don't think that this entire amount will be, for lack of a better word, wasted. I think we'll still get some value out of it.
Okay.
Even with a redesign of the interior spaces.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying that. That was my questions. Does any other member have any questions for him? Hearing none, I entertain a motion to adjourn, please.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion to adjourn and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.
I'd like to call the Land Use and Economic Development Committee meeting to order. Ms. Clerk, is this meeting properly noticed by the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you, ma'am. First on the agenda is the approval of minutes from the regular Committee on Land Use and Economic Development meeting held on October the 8th, 2018.
Move for approval.
Do I have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any corrections to these minutes? Hearing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The minutes stand approved as presented.
You bugging me?
Next agenda item is the Accommodation Tax Advisory Commission grant recommendations. Mr. Jim Rozier. Jim.
Channel 4, you want yours too?
Thank you.
I think she heard you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Marietta has kindly offered to hand out some information to you.
Thank you.
I had a meeting on November 5th of the committee, the Accommodations Tax Committee, and what we just passed out to you is a list of their recommendations, a list that shows you the amount requested by the different organizations and amount that the committee ended up recommending that be awarded. You notice there's $1,134,000 in applications, and the committee is recommending that you award $416,200 total. The Berkeley Chamber of Commerce, the committee decided they were more comfortable with leaving that to your discretion because they don't know where the whole thing stands at this point. We've been given no information, so we didn't know exactly what to do with that. One thing that I did pass out to you is this Berkeley County Blue Ways, the Soil and Water Conservation District, put this together. Blue Ways program has been around Berkeley County for about 15 years now. And the grant that they got, they put this book together that, quite frankly, is magnificent, I think. It has 175 miles of canoeing and kayaking trails in it. 23 different trails. They are mapped and marked, and the book is full of information of what you go see on those trails, the history on those trails, etc. The application they have in this year, that they plan to take that and do a book like this for walking trails in Berkeley County and biking trails in Berkeley County. And then They plan to do billboards and other advertising methods to bring folks into Burke County to do what these books offer them the opportunity to do. So I think it's poster child for what accommodations tax should be spent on. I know tonight I'm hitting you with the recommendations. I will be coming back on the 26th, however, to discuss this further and give you the opportunity then to vote on it, I suppose, at full council. But if you have any questions now, I can certainly try to answer them. Three of the organizations last year did not, four maybe, did not get their money, didn't ask for it. One did ask for it, the rescue squad, but they disbanded and turned that over to the sheriff's department, so they gave the money back. The ones that have applied this year, some of them, I think most of them applied last year also, if not all of them. Museum has several projects going on that are very, very good projects. Every project here is a good project. You'll notice the Lord Berkeley Conservation Trust had an application last time and got money last time. They did not ask for anything this time. They did it first, then they withdrew it because they're still working on their project, and they don't have another project that they'll be working on in the next 12 months, so they figured wait till the next time around to ask for more money since they have plenty to do right now. There's $1,049,000, I think. Is that $1,049,000 total money available in the fund? I put $50,000 on the bottom of this. It has to be spent now, but actually it's $130,000. I wrote down the wrong number. It's $130,000 of state funds that has to be spent now. State requires it to be spent now. There's two organizations in Berkeley County that those funds can go to. The committee did not make a recommendation on that, but there's two organizations in Berkeley that serve Berkeley County that it's legal for these funds to be passed through for promotion, and that's the Berkeley County Chamber of Commerce and the Santee Cooper Countries. So that's something council should consider. The state says it has to be spent. So that's $130,000.
And Mr. Chairman, what is the deadline for those funds?
I'm sorry.
What's the deadlines? What's the date it's got to be spent?
State deadline's already passed. Am I right on that?
There's typically the fiscal year, June 30th, but they've been lenient the last 2 years.
We have 2 years of money there right now.
Okay, so we still have a little time before we have to turn it back into the state or whatever to allocate it.
Come up here with me. Good luck in here.
Typically, the deadline is June 30 of each year. We have to send an annual report showing where the money went and made sure that it's for the purpose that they intended it for. So June 30 of 18 has already passed, so we should have till June 30 of 19 to make that
$130,000.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which we'll add to it, of course, this year. So
correct.
It'll
okay.
be more.
Thank you.
I don't want to. You can stay up here with me if you want to.
Stand by.
Make one statement if you will.
Yes, please.
Yes. Okay. Not to give anybody more problems than they already have, but I've been trying for about a year to have this meeting and bring this to you, and I've been told to hold off. Because we made a presentation to you about a year ago, maybe a little over a year ago, asking for direction on hiring a firm to design some publicity for Burke County, some marketing, and I was told I had to wait till I got information back. But then I went a couple, 3-4 weeks ago and said, I'm going to have a committee meeting and bring some information to council, and that's what I did. So I was told not to until then. Now, it wasn't told to then. I decided this was this past time, and I got to get it done. So we can talk about that in private if you want to, but it is a personnel thing. So,
Mr. Chairman,
I think Councilman Payne.
I think I asked first, but it's okay.
Councilman Davis, I'm sorry.
Thank you. I thought I got my concern in this regard is there a breakdown in relationship to these sums of money that has been requested and the specific use allocation of the funds?
Yes, sir. That was sent by clerk of council's office, she scanned it and sent it out to the council members, I believe.
When? Do you know when we received it?
Last week.
I sure like to see it. You got a copy with you?
I do have one copy.
Please.
I could have copies made.
I'm the only person seeming to don't have it, so please.
Yeah. It's in your packets.
You're not in this packet here.
Ms. Davis, I could get you a copy.
Please.
Okay. And again, I'm going to be coming back on 26, if you want to just wait and look over everything and discuss it on 26.
Yeah, Councilman Davis, what I plan to do tonight is just some information and hold a special committee meeting on the 26th prior
to. That's fine. That's
fine. And give council members enough time to go over everything and think about it. We're talking about a committee on 26. Then we're moving on out to full council that night without any kind of objections from council. So we're going to try to gather some information tonight.
Okay.
You finished, Ms. Davis?
Yes, I am.
All right. Councilman Pinckney.
Mr. Chairman, I'll just wait until the 26th and ask my questions then. Okay. Sure. And let my concerns be known. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, I did have a couple questions. Southeastern Wildlife Expo, that's the Wildlife Expo downtown Charleston.
That's right.
I see the committee's wanting to give them $10,000.
Yes, that's what we gave them last year. Yes.
Right. My question is, how much bang do we get for that buck by the investment in the Wildlife Expo?
Sure.
Now, I know that they put, because people stay in the Somerville hotels for that expo down there.
Yes, sir.
But to me, they would stay in there anyway, whether we gave them the $10,000 or not.
Well, yes, sir, that's probably true.
Right.
But there's several things that I think Berkeley County gets from that. The hotel stays one thing, that's what we're supposed to get.
Right.
Daniel Island fills up for that on the hotels. The other thing that I think we get a real bang for our buck, we have people from all over the world, over 40,000 people come into that festival. Overwhelming majority from outside this area, and I think we get spotlighted in a very, very positive way for the whole low country.
Do they hand out brochures during that time where hopefully we get Cypress Gardens back up and going, Mapkin, your museum, these types of things that they can come to Berkeley County experience, have the Berkeley County experience?
We have an opportunity to have a booth, a table, or whatever,
right,
in this festival if we'd like to. And that can be set up to hand out things like this, to pass out brochures, to publicize Berkeley County,
right,
and a lot of people.
Correct.
So, right. Yes, sir, that can be done, and that won't cost us a penny.
Right.
So,
and I'm sure you probably agree with me when we say, the main objective to these funds is to put more heads in beds to people stay so they'll pay more accommodation tax and start building on that.
Absolutely.
Do you have a feel for the hotels with the projects we did last year making a positive impact on people coming and staying in the hotels? Or do you think it might be something that's going to take four or 5 years out to get it?
I honestly don't know the answer to that. I will tell you that in our area where we have the most hotels, the Somerville exit's over there, and there's three or four more hotels built over there,
right,
and more in the planning. So I don't know that you can look at the existing hotels and say whether we caused less or more stays because so many have opened up that spread that business around. So I think it's going to take a little settling of the business there before you go determine. When you open up a new hotel every two or three months, it's pretty tough to gauge what you're doing and what you're not doing.
Okay. Mr. Chairman?
Councilman Cox.
A couple points there. First of all, with the Southeastern Wildlife Exposition, it's impossible to get a hotel in Somerville, downtown Charleston, Daniel Island during that period of time.
Yes.
They're book solid. I did come home today and got off at the Ashley Phosphate exit, and I noticed three or four new hotels being built right now. We have them at Somerville exit. So we are flooding the market with a ton of rooms right now that we didn't have in the past. $10,000 to a Southeastern Wildlife Exposition is a small amount compared to the number of heads and beds we're going to get from that. We had a great opportunity to meet with Mr. Houndsen and Ms. Morgan, yourself and I, the other week. And the Flower Town Festival, we talked about how that has grown over the years. No one would have ever expected that to put as many heads and beds as it does. But that is a huge program now, festival, for $10,000. There's a lot of monies on here that are being spent that are not putting heads in beds, but those two, if you look at the $200,000 of Cypress Gardens will never put as many heads in beds as the $10,000 from Southeastern Wildlife Exposition or from the Somerville Flower Town Festival. Those are just people coming in town specifically for those festivals, not saying that Cypress Gardens doesn't need it or deserve it and won't be a crown jewel to bring people in, just saying for a small investment of $10,000, it's not much. One thing, Mr. Rozier, I would like to see by the 26th is the accounting for the people we gave money to last year.
Sure.
I want to see how it was spent and how they project it was used to bring heads in beds or people to our county, but at least an accounting for the money, because I have yet to see that.
I'll get you some information on that. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. I will say, Mr. Cox, you make a good point about Cypress Gardens, but the thought process here is Cypress Gardens alone won't do that. The museum alone won't bring that many people in for heads and beds. Mepkin Abbey alone won't do that. The Santee Canal Park alone won't do that. The paddling trails alone won't do that. But by putting these things together, and I've left some out and I'm sorry, but by putting these things together, we give a reason for people to stay 2 or 3 or 4 days in Berkeley County, not just for Cypress Gardens, but to come and participate in all those activities. Then we have the synergy to bring people into Berkeley County that will stay longer. We'll come here to come to Berkeley County, not to come to Charleston, but to come to Berkeley County because of the things we're promoting that they can do when they get here.
I guess the point I'm making, Mr. Rozier, is $200,000. We're already paying, is it $1 mil on our taxes?
That's correct.
Yep. $1 mil, that's almost $1 million for Cypress Gardens every year. And now we're going to take $200,000 more in hand to Cypress Gardens. Maybe the Hotel Association can do a little better with advertising with that $200,000 to bring more heads and beds, because the citizens of Berkeley County are already dropping $1 million into that project.
And that's good, except that you can't give it to the hotels to advertise with. It can only be given, only be spent through nonprofits and government agencies. That's the only way the money can be spent by law.
But can the money not go through the chamber for advertising?
That's your decision. Yes, sir, it can.
That is an opportunity.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And I'm certainly not saying that can't be. I'm just saying it can't be given directly to private business.
No, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Davis.
I just want to add in, Cypress Garden, that's an astronomical sum of money. It was a loser from the beginning. It continued to be a loser in that regard. Jim, I know your association with Cypress Garden when you were on county council. You was very zealous about Cypress Garden. I'm very leery of $200,000 to Cypress Garden.
Let me hasten to add to that, and I have no problem what you're saying, but let me hasten to add that this is a recommendation. You gentlemen make the decision.
Mr. Chairman, heck of a recommendation.
Councilman Whitley.
I just want to state for the record, I'm for abolishing this tax. And so.
With you.
And that's, I'm okay
not,
with that.
And that's not a reflection on your good work.
Don't take it that way, no,
and
sir.
And so, we don't tax any other industry in this way, but that's a fight for a different day. So I just want, on the record, I would get out of this business. But since we're in this business, I want to thank you and thank your committee for what you are doing under the Act. And I'll be making phone calls and looking at it between now and the 26th, but I appreciate your work.
And I do have a tremendous love for Cypress Gardens, but let me tell you, what you gentlemen do on this doesn't change a thing I eat tomorrow, no matter what you do, okay? So, so I'm not up here looking for you to do a cockeyed thing you don't want to do. I'm just bringing you the recommendation of my council. I'm still going to eat the same thing tomorrow, no matter what you do.
Yeah.
We thank you, Chairman. Is there any other questions?
Any other questions?
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Again, I'll have a special committee meeting on the 26th, and we'll vote our recommendations, and we'll forward the full council the night of the 26th. Next, we have the Chamber of Commerce discussion of the accommodation tax funds, and the president of the chamber, Mr. Kevin Hauser. Kevin.
That's your intro song.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I'm sure I'm probably glad I missed Mr. Whitley's comment here, but anyhow, I didn't catch that.
I heard Bad to the Bone playing on a ringtone, and I thought it was your introduction song.
Oh, I see, and I'm glad I left my phone over there. So, no, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the opportunity to address your committee tonight. I do would like to make a few points about the accommodation fee. Also, I would like to need about 7 or 8 minutes. In the second part of which, I will make a proposal to this committee that I hope will address and allay the specific concern that Mr. Whitley just brought up about wanting to abolish the fee/tax. And I'm hoping we can avoid that, and I do have a proposal of a way that I would hope that the committee would find suitable, or certainly at least give it its due consideration. So I will then begin by saying I do want to pick up on the comment that Mr. Rozier offered, because we in the accommodations tax oversight committee meeting that was held on November the 5th, the committee did pass on voting on the or discussing the Chamber of Commerce's application for grant funding from the accommodation tax and accommodation fee. I contacted Mr. Rozier on the 7th and met with him and expressed to him my concern over the fact that the chamber's request was not voted on. I didn't think there was a legitimate reason that the application should not have been discussed that day, and I asked Mr. Rozier if he would reconvene his committee prior to the submittals going to county council of all the grant applications and discuss the chamber's grant. He did tell me that the timing would not work out for that to occur, but I did want to say that on behalf of the chamber, Mr. Rozier, if you're still in the room, there you are, thank you very much. We certainly sincerely appreciate your invitation to have me at your home to discuss this and to reconvene your committee later on, if that's what ends up being the appropriate thing, to discuss that. I and the chamber and their board truly appreciate that very much. Thank you. We are hopeful. The Chamber of Commerce is hopeful, as there appears to be an excess of funding available. The total amount requested through the grant applications does not seem to quite reach the amount of funding that's available for grants. So we are hopeful that the advisory committee will recommend that county council fully funds the chamber's request. Now, I will agree without going down the path, I will agree that the chamber situation is unique among applicants. And in the interest of not taking any more of this committee's time by coming back again, I'd like to share a few points for the committee's consideration when you do evaluate the chamber's grant request. First and foremost, our lodging facilities are experiencing a gradual but consistent decline in occupancy and room rates, and that's especially true on the weekends. And this situation is not going to improve as new hotels that are already planned, already permitted, come online here in the next 1 to 3 years. Those we already have need help now, and their employees need help now. It doesn't take as many employees if you don't have as many guests to care for. Lodging businesses have been essentially 2 years without a consistent marketing campaign working for them, and they're feeling it. I'd like to support the Chamber's request by repeating a comment that was actually offered by Mr. Rozier in this room in April of 2017 when he was referencing the expenditure of accommodation funds, and he said at that time, the goal of it is to put people in hotels. There's no question about that. Now, I've been to enough council meetings to understand that many of you, maybe all of you, put great stock in what Mr. Rozier says, and we all recognize the love he has for Berkeley County. Now, later in that same meeting, he went on to say, I'll tell you this, the Chamber has done a great job of filling those hotels. Absolutely, no question about it, was his comment. So I ask you to please to weigh those words of his carefully when considering the Chamber's request. Now I want to get to the proposal I mentioned earlier, because I do have a proposal that I feel like might benefit everyone that's involved with accommodations revenues, and not the least of which is this county council. On the broader issue, Mr. Chairman, several of you have stated over time you're tired of dealing with the accommodations issue. You don't want to be in the advertising marketing business. You have $100 million that you're stewards of, but you spend an inordinate amount of time on an amount that's less than 1% of the total that you're responsible for. You don't think it's a good idea that county council has become involved with the interest of this small segment of people in Berkeley County. Maybe that's arguable. I think that that actually kind of defines the very concept of a special tax district. Now this fee is not a special tax district, but the concept is very similar. It also, I think, thinking of it in that fashion helps to clarify the intent of the original efforts of the Chamber of Commerce, the lodging owners, and county council when this whole thing began. So all of those concerns of councils are very reasonable statements, but there is one other sentiment that I struggle with. I have to tell you that I struggle with it. I struggle understanding it, and that's the one that says, with regard to the Berkeley County accommodations fee, we don't need to be beholden to decisions of past county councils. And I hope, really, truly, I hope that I have just misunderstood or mistaken the meaning of that sentiment. Because, I mean, we can't just ignore the ordinance that exists, nor can we ignore what it ordains. So whatever the case, Mr. Chairman, I think there's a very straightforward solution that relieves your committee, county council, of virtually all of this frustration and time wasting. You would simply have to initiate the following steps. First, recognize there is a distinct difference between the state accommodations tax funds and the Berkeley County accommodations fee funds, and that the state's guidelines for expending the funds apply only to the state funds. They do not apply to our county's accommodation fee funds, and to the best that I can determine, they never have. Leave the current accommodations tax oversight committee in place to advise you, to advise county council, as to the expenditures of state accommodations tax funds. These funds apparently haven't been any source that I can determine of any controversy, current or past. Also, authorize the formation of an accommodations fee oversight committee consisting of Berkeley County lodging industry owners and or their agents to advise county council as to the expenditures of the county accommodations fee funds. Again, there is nothing in the state code of laws that I can find that prevents you from doing this. And in doing so, you reduce your role in the accommodations fee process and the accompanying allotment of time to that of asking a single question one time a year to the lodging owners. Are you satisfied with how the money's being spent? Just like that, you're out of the advertising business. It can be just that simple. In closing, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to say on behalf of the chamber that despite the events of the past few years, Berkeley County government and Berkeley County Council are not enemies of the Chamber of Commerce. The Chamber wants only one thing, to do what's best for Berkeley County. And we truly believe that you all want the same thing. And working together, truly working together, is what's best for Berkeley County. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That concludes my remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Housen. Do we have any questions
or comments? Chairman.
Councilman Newell.
Mr. Housen, you said that there was a decline in hotel stays. Was that what I heard?
That's what we're hearing from the hotels, yes, sir.
That's what you're hearing from the hotels? Because I'm looking here, and I see that just last year, 2017, we had, I don't know, passengers traveling within 2018 already. It's about 15,000 people are passing through the gates of the airport every day. So they had to add two additional new airlines with nonstop service to five different new cities. Second, we have a situation where the top origin of these folks are coming from North Carolina, Florida, Pennsylvania, Georgia, Virginia, New York, Texas, Ohio, quote unquote, hold the jokes, please. California.
It's not a laughing matter.
It's not. Maryland. And the top origin cities are New York, Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, Atlanta, Charlotte, Chicago, Dallas, Miami, Boston, and so forth. Now, I see a few highlights here that tells me that 6.9 million visitors came to the greater Charleston area in 2017, which was a 26% increase from 2016. Now, the total labor earnings that through tourism equate about $2.7 billion in 2017. Now, and normally when folks come here, they stay here about four nights. And they spend an average about $217 per adult per day, which is about $826 per adult per trip. So how does this back up what you're saying, that the hotels are telling you that there's less people staying in there? Is it because more hotels are being built in that area, so it's being spread out? So what is it? Is it because of lack of advertising, or is it a lack of, or because of competition?
Mr. Newell, I can't give you a complete answer to your question. I can, though, tell you that that Mrs. Wiggins, who along with her family owns several properties in Berkeley County, as you're well aware,
yes, sir,
said in the paper that she feels it, that since the advertising has gone away, the weekend traffic is not what it once was.
Okay.
I'd be glad to be able to get some better information for you.
Thank
to
you.
Help support these statements and try to understand the whys and wherefores.
Believe me, I'm not trying to question Ms. Wiggins at all. But
very legitimate
question. When I read something like this that disputes what you're saying, can you just give me some information? I appreciate it.
No problem.
Thank you, buddy.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Cox.
A couple points. I fear that it would not be as simple as you say just to have one committee for the fee and one for the state funds. Because regardless of who we appoint for that committee, we still have some responsibility in how the funds are expended. Just like we sat down Monday a week ago and went through the records and so forth that the chamber had provided for the accommodation tax, I still have questions. I would still like those documents that I requested last Monday. I haven't gotten all of those, but I'm sure they're on the way. I think you will agree there were some lack of internal controls. When one person approves the invoices, one person signs the checks, one person approves everything, a CPA simply checks the code on it, I have concern. That's not great internal controls. When I see documents signed, invoices paid that says to be determined, and we don't know what we're getting for it, that's a point of concern for me. So for me sitting up here simply to say this committee can do it is not quite good enough, just like I asked Mr. Rozier to give me a backup of what was spent last year. I feel that obligation to the public, to the people who elected us, to take the time to look at the numbers and back it up. This accommodation tax or fee, as you would have it, does serve an industry. It serves the hotels. I do believe it brings heads in beds. We had a great discussion the other day. I had a whole new enlightenment after we finished it. I'm just not sure this council needs to be in that business of having to have the oversight for that advertising. If every one of the hotel owners wants to be in that business, they can be in the business of doing their own advertising, just like the car dealers and everyone else. They do their own advertising. I'm going to keep an open mind and go through it, but I certainly hope you will agree with me that handing $600,000 or $800,000 a year to an organization with not the tightest internal controls, and it's taken a year and a half for us to get the records to go through, it's kind of a difficult situation to put us in. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilman Pinckney.
Let me say this. For the last 20 years, based on facts, hotel, we're doing just fine. And up until we changed the way business was being done with the accommodation tax money, they start declining. It wasn't broken, but we start messing with it. And I can understand with that amount of money being just sitting there, that was a low-hanging fruit. So I've got some concerns there. When you talk about internal control, we discussed that earlier tonight here. That's why we got to take some action that we're taking tonight. So it happens from time to time. I'm a small business owner. Sometimes I got to take some hard looks too, how I'm spending the money. And that's applicable to everybody. And I know when it comes to the chairman, I may be out of order, but you can tell me and I'll shut down. But when it came out on the paper, it says that they didn't find anything unscrupulous about the chamber after the investigation. So I'm at a loss as to why we're still stirring in the pot of soup when, according to the investigation, all is well. There may need to be some adjustments made, but then here are the hotels. They're stuck because they're not getting the advertisement that they used to get. So naturally, there's no heads in bed. Once again, me as a small business owner, I can better advertise my business than you can. You might know something about funeral services, but I do it on a day-to-day basis. And I wouldn't want to put my money in anybody's hand just because you had to go through a few arrangements to depend on you to keep my business afloat. And here again, somebody stated it. I think we need to get out of that. We don't need to be in the advertising business. Let those people who can best advertise for themselves do that. And that's what we need to do and move forward, because we've got a whole lot of other issues that we need to be dealing with that has a more direct effect on the citizens of Berkeley County than the accommodation tax money. Let the money go where it's supposed to go. And let's move forward and make Berkeley County the best we can possibly make. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pinckney. Any other discussions?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to make one final comment.
Yes, Kevin.
And that would be, and mainly to Councilman Cox. I just mentioned a few minutes ago how we truly want to rebuild a relationship that existed and struggled, and now we have that chance again to be back in the bridge building business, and this is an opportunity. So I agree with you. You don't need to be putting an inordinate amount of time into the administration of the accommodations fee, but I believe we can work together and develop a system that makes it realistic for everyone and ultimately provides the benefits it was designed to provide. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Kevin. Councilman Cox.
And Mr. Houndsman, I would just like to say I hear you, I agree with you, but I think after Monday you sat through an hour and a half meeting, I think you would have to share some of the concerns that I have or had about what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And to answer Mr. Pinckney's question, the letter that went to the Post and Courier, the chamber was never the subject of any investigation that I know of. You would have received a target letter. And you yourself told me on more than one occasion that y'all had never received a target letter. So you were not the subject of investigation. Possibly someone y'all were dealing with may have been, but y'all were never subject. So if you were never the subject, you can never be cleared. That was a misinterpretation in the paper, Ms. Ringe. Thank you.
Okay, just a couple.
Can I just do a follow-up?
Yes, please. Mr. Payton.
And it's not trying to debate the issue, but as far as the general public was concerned, they thought that the chamber had done something unscrupulous based on whether they saw it in the paper, what was said, or what was being told to folks. And that was a problem. There was a lot of innuendos being spread as a result of the investigation. And I know that to be a fact. So whether or not it was misprinted or misunderstood, it was still being said. So as you stated, we need to work collectively together and move forward for the betterment of the county as a whole. And I'm okay with that. I'm through.
Thank you, Mr. Payton. I would like to just follow up with just a few comments on this. This is a very important issue. There's a lot of people depend on this as far as employment and the hotel industry. You look over this list, there's a lot of good things on this list. What I would like to do as chairman of the committee is to ask if Chairman Rozier, President Housen, Councilman Pinckney, and Councilman Cox join me to form a little task force committee. Let's sit down, let's talk about this thing, let's see what we get worked out, and then come back and make recommendations back to the council. And just see if we can work this thing out for a win-win situation. And I think Councilman Cox has some accounting questions, the way the accounting and accountability, maybe we could address those and critique some of that stuff that would come up that everybody could live with. We don't leave Chairman Rozier out with his group and needing these funds. I just think that we can put our heads together and come out to everybody will be funded one way or the other. Chairman Rozier,
I won't be available after the 1st of December.
Okay, and that's fine. I'm with you on that, Jim. So if y'all, the two council members, if y'all don't have any objections, I'd like to put that together.
That's fine.
That's fine with you, Councilman Pinckney?
I'm fine with it.
Good. Thank you very much. Thank you, Kevin.
Good. I'll look forward to it. Thank you, sir.
Good. Thank you. Next on the agenda is the consideration prior to first reading an ordinance to modify the official zoning and development standards maps of Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regard to Kevin Berry on behalf of Gloria and Norman Driggers for TMS 222-10-00-019. This is 0.85 acres located on Old Somerville Road in the vicinity of Somerville, South Carolina, from R2 Manufactured Residential District to GC General Commercial District and Council District 4. I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion on this? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Next, we have an ordinance to modify the official zoning and development standards maps of Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regard to Kimchi Nugent for TMS 244-06-00-008.
Move for denial.
1.33 acres located on Liberty Hall Road in the vicinity of Goose Creek, South Carolina, from R2 Manufactured Residential District to GC General Commercial District and Council District 3. I have a motion. Do I have a second for the denial? We have a second for the denial. Are there any discussions?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Newell.
Ms. Allison, why was this denied?
We found the uses allowable under general commercial incompatible in the context of the area concern. The subject property is surrounded by R2 zoning, so we were concerned that it wasn't compatible, it didn't align with the comprehensive plan future land use recommendation, and we thought it could be potentially construed as a spot zoning. Planning Commission also recommended denial in a unanimous vote.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Whitley.
I will note Councilman Gunn, who is fighting cancer and had to leave early due to that and for no other reason, expressed that he supports denial, and this is in his district, so for the council's benefit.
Good, thank you. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I have a motion and a second to deny. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. This is review prior to second reading, bill number 18-60, an ordinance to modify the official zoning and
approval.
We have a motion, we have a second.
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Did you miss one?
Don't think.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll come back to you. Okay.
Which one?
Is any opposed to that on bill number 1860?
No.
Hearing none. That passes. We'll go back up to item number 3. This is the first reading, an ordinance to modify the official zoning and development standards maps in Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regard to Leroy Rivers for TMS 224-0001-009.
Move this for approval.
This is 2 acres located on Highway 52 Road in the vicinity of the Strawberry Community, South Carolina, from GC General Commercial District to RNC Rural and Neighborhood Commercial District and Council District 8. I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. We just passed 1860 for second reading. We go to bill number 1861.
Move for approval.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Next second reading, we have bill number 1862, an ordinance to amend the text of this Stratamore PD-RC Plan Development Regional Commercial Guidelines for Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regard to GSR Jedburgh LLC and the Ingema Corporation for TMS numbers 207-0001-109, 207-0001-113, 207-0001-114, 207-0001-115, 207-0001-116, 125, and 134, located on Stratamore and Jedburgh Roads in the New Hope community in Council District 7.
Move for approval for our discussion.
We have a motion. We have a second for discussion.
Second.
We have a second. All right, discussion.
Okay, I spoke with Ms. Simmons in regards to this, and we've got some opportunities here to hopefully come up with some guidelines that we can move forward and be crystal clear as to how we're going to deal with that. Is that correct, Ms. Simmons?
That is correct.
And I need your input as far as the discussion that we had and what some of the options that's available to us. So from this point on, I'm going to listen, okay?
Okay. So as you guys are aware, the applicant is seeking to increase the height allowance for signage from 80 feet to 150 feet and the allowable square footage for sign face from 250 square feet to 350 square feet per side. The intent is to establish signage similar to what was permitted previously by the BZA for the Flying J signage that you see on I-26. When we evaluated the text amendment, we found that it was silent in addressing the quantity of signs that could be established and also lacked any explicit verbiage on where the signs could be placed. So as Mr. Pinckney stated, we met last week and we came up with some potential verbiage. and that is to place parameters for the location of the tall monopole sign so that it may only be placed along or oriented to I-26, adding that under no circumstances can the sign be placed on Jedburgh or Strathmore Road frontages. Standards for signage established on those frontages shall follow the standards established within the existing PD. And then also to restrict the quantity of signs to one, however, giving the opportunity for additional tenants to share signage on this monopole sign by increasing the allowable square footage from 315 to 630, allowing for an additional 315 square feet for additional tenants to place their signage on the tall monopole sign.
And that would, in my estimation, have a very discreet number, one, and if any additional folks want to share that, it would be high enough so that could be done and make sure that it doesn't go in Jedburgh Road under no circumstances. It would be on the frontage road facing the interstate. So that's what we have to offer tonight, and we appreciate your input. And especially since there's already one there at the Flying J, you know, and we can't show any partiality here.
Any other discussion? Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Next, we have bill number 1863, an ordinance.
Move approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Next, we have bill number 1864.
Move for approval.
We have a motion. We have a second.
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Next, we go to third reading, bill number 1853.
Move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Next, we have bill number 1854.
Move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Next, we have bill number 1855.
Move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries.
Move for adjournment.
Second.
We have a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you. That's why you got the ACC championship. We get back from Charlotte.
You need that for help.
Since you made the first of the year.
Okay. Oh, thank you, man. I don't know. Who's next up?
And I think that me and Kevin will get.
Kevin's thinking he's thanks for folks like wrong. You.
Kevin's not doing anything wrong, but they don't have a good accounting that he's comfortable with. I think if we get together,
yes, man, what I did now.
I know. It's got us in a bad spot. You know, they kind of pull them. I appreciate that. We'll do that. That's right. Good. Thank you.
Mr. Davis.
I'm up.
Yeah, you up.
Like you said, that's not going to stop.
That's
good.
Just mess me all you want.
I'd like to call the Committee on Community Service meeting to order, please.
Do it, Chairman.
Ms. Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
First on the agenda is approval of the minutes from the regular committee meeting, community service meeting held on October the 8th, 2018.
Move for approval.
I need a second.
Second.
Are there any corrections to these minutes? All those in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The minutes stand approved as presented. First on the agenda is an ordinance to establish Community Development Advisory Board for Berkeley County, South Carolina. Ms. Victoria Marshall.
Move for approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Second on the agenda is consideration of a resolution authorizing a PAR grant application on behalf of the Kitfield Community Park.
Move for approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. I entertain a motion to adjourn.
So
my God. Thank you. That's what an election will do for you. Thank you very much, my friends.
Mr. Davis, I actually would like some input for council on the setup of this advisory board.
You got to do it next time, sweetie.
Next time? Yeah. Okay, perfect. Then
thank you. I promise.
I will come with you, to you with a draft on
please.
What I'm
we got first.
Suggesting, and then we can go from there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Yeah. Davis.
You can put anything you want in there, sweetheart. Thank you.
Don't be saying sweetheart.
Oh.
Sorry about that. Old school. Me too. Here comes the fireworks. I would like to call the Committee on Justice and Public Safety meeting to order. Ms. Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
First on my agenda is the termination of Deputy Supervisor
effective
immediately.
Mr. Chairman, before we get to that matter, I'd like to move to amend the agenda for exigent circumstances to hire civil counsel on behalf of the county for any injunctive relief we may need to have any misappropriated funds frozen or retrieved. And I believe the exigent circumstance, Mr. Chairman, is the necessity of getting that money either in escrow or back as soon as possible.
Councilman Whitley, is that in the form of a motion?
That's my motion to amend the agenda for exigent circumstances.
And I'll second that.
Do I have any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. It is approved.
Mr. Chairman, I would note for purposes of the Freedom of Information Act that passed by unanimous vote, which is the necessary two-thirds required to find an exigent circumstance.
Thank you, Councilman Whitley.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion for item one, the termination of Deputy Supervisor effective immediately.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Do I have any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The motion carries.
Mr. Chairman, I would
note. The council, I think the deputy supervisor, my right, would like y'all to clarify for the record.
Present company excluded.
Right. I think, won't we just make him sweat?
I do think we should revote that.
All right, how about this? Termination of Deputy Supervisor Timothy Callinan effective immediately.
That your motion, Mr. Shrelnick?
Yes.
That would be my second. And we can revote.
Any discussion?
Just briefly, Al.
Oh, Lord.
You know, I got terminated previously. and it was on Live 5 News. And it offended my mother so greatly, she changed to Channel 4 in reference to catching the news. I'm just going to abscond, excuse myself from voting. I just don't like the word termination in a public setting. That's it. I just excuse myself.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I would like to add that the deputy supervisor present
has done more with this county than most taxpayers can ever understand. He has saved this county millions of dollars when he was county attorney, assistant attorney. And he has done a lot of great things when he's taken over the deputy supervisor position. And it's my hope that he is retained, because he is a very valuable cog in this mechanism that we call local government. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The motion carries.
Mr. Chairman, I would note under state law that it passes with the 2/3 majority.
Thank you. Number two on my agenda is authorization to seek SLED investigation of misappropriation of funds.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Whitley.
I would move to authorize the Vice Chairman of Council, Jack Schrellnight, to issue a formal request to the Chief of SLED to seek an immediate criminal investigation into possible misconduct in office and possible misappropriation of funds.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
There you go again. I was in Marlboro County this afternoon when this emergency meeting was going on, so I don't feel comfortable to entertain or participate, but I just reserved my right to excuse myself. I haven't done this about two times in 20-something years on county council, but my lovely wife and I, we were traveling from Marlboro County this afternoon, so I got it kind of late. So I'm just going to stay on the sideline again, and this specifically on this issue.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Motion carries. Number three on my agenda is authorization of forensic audit.
Move for approval.
Second.
Any discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, what I will ask on the forensic audit, I would like to have each council member the opportunity to identify the areas that they would like looked into. And then we'll also have a list, and we'll put that list together.
Sounds good.
So we will be able to give the auditors the list of things that we want to look into.
Ms. Kathy, make sure you note that.
Mr. Chairman, might I?
Mr. Whitley.
I'm sure we will not have support from the administration to execute this vote. So this motion needs clarification on who, what, when, and how we will choose a forensic auditor. So I would vote for this, but I would ask that the motion be we come back to either this committee or finance, because we'll need a source of funds. Forensic audits are not cheap. To dictate who, when, and how we're going to choose the forensic auditor, how it's going to be bid and selected, and so forth. So my only concern on this vote is the execution of it on the tail end. And so I would, I think I would move to amend your main motion to have a forensic audit. I'd move for an amendment for a subset of council to make a further recommendation on the execution of the main motion. That would be my amendment.
Okay. And later.
Or will you amend your motion to, here's what I would suggest.
Put it in layman's terms now.
Will you withdraw your motion and I'll make the main motion on the forensic audit?
You got it. Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, I would move for a forensic audit and to direct the vice chairman and Councilman Cox to select the process or entity to conduct a forensic audit and to gather the topics for what they will audit, and bring that back to Finance Committee for final vote.
I have a second.
Second.
Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Oh, Lord.
No, my only concern in this regard is we have a new supervisor that's coming in January, and I'm just concerned about the cost associated with an audit. I would think it would be routine or systematic that the new supervisor coming in would take advantage of a forensic audit before he assumed his position. And so I'm just concerned about expenditures of taxpayers'
funds with about 30 days before we get a new solicitor, I mean, a new supervisor in office. That's my concern.
Mr. Chairman,
I'm not opposed to it.
I can say this, that whenever somebody goes and spends $49,000, you know, what else has been spent that we need to look at so the supervisor coming in isn't shortchanged?
But I think, I thought that was a process of our system as before he takes office, that there would be an aspect of some audit that would take place. But, Mr. Cox, I'll defer to you being a tax accountant in this regard.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Cox.
Seeing how we're already in the middle of November, and the supervisor-elect will take office in January, I don't see there's any way possible that you're going to select a firm who is ready to hit the ground running with a forensic audit between now and January the 1st. So I agree with Mr. Davis. We could kill two birds with the one proverbial stone. Yeah. Mr. Cribb will have an opportunity to have his input in what he would like to see in a forensic audit, as well as the council members. So I think we're in the same place, okay. Mr. Davis.
I'll withdraw my motion and agree that I think it's important to have a forensic audit,
agreed.
But let's wait till we can have a supervisor execute that call. And I don't want it to interfere with any potential criminal investigation anyway.
Thank you, Miss. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So we'll move.
And fourth on my agenda, excuse me.
Go, Steve. Freeze on the supervisor's authority to expend any county funds. Speak now, forever hold your peace.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Whitley.
Under South Carolina Code 49420, supervisor is given 12 powers and duties. One of those duties is to supervise the expenditure of funds, which I think he has greatly failed the people of Berkeley County and this council. But all the powers are limited, if you read the code section, by that which was appropriated by council. Never were monies appropriated by council for the expenditure of $49,900 for a severance package. Never did council agree to a severance contract. I will even note that we have a copy of the severance agreement between the deputy supervisor and the supervisor, and the county attorney never saw it, wrote it, got an opinion on it, was not consulted before this was executed between the supervisor and deputy supervisor. We have a county attorney who does our legal work and contracts and everything in between, and he saw this for the first time at lunch today, and it was executed last Thursday. So I have no trust in the execution of the supervisor's powers to supervise the expenditure of funds appropriated by council. None. I also recognize we're limited in stripping the supervisor of his powers. So I don't think we can fully remove his powers between now and the end of the year to supervise that which we have appropriated as a council. But beyond that which we've appropriated, I would move to suspend the supervisor's power at whatever authority he believes to expend any funds that have not been previously approved and appropriated by county council.
Second.
Do you have any discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. My good friend, Mr. Jim Roger, he taught me this very well. He always stated, and I agree, and it supports your motion, he says that county council sets the policy. And we're responsible for setting the policy. So if the policy hadn't been established, then it should not be effective. I'll just share that. Jim, I want to share this with you because you made a point of teaching me that all these years I was on county council. Council sets the policy, and the supervisor executes those policies. And so in that vein, I support you, this motion, I do.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, nay. Motion carries.
Move for adjournment.
No, Mr. Chairman. Nope. We have an amended item. I would move to authorize the county attorney to hire civil counsel as needed for injunctive relief to recover any and all monies misappropriated from the county coffers.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Motion carries. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
So moved.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. We are adjourned.
We have one more meeting about all those items.
Yeah.
That was just committee. We got to report it out to county council.
Yeah, the special council meeting will be starting up in just a few minutes.
We started up now? I'm good. She's good.
I'd like to call the special county council meeting to order. I'd like to call the special county council meeting to order. Ms. Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed by the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you, ma'am. First is public discussion. If you signed up to address council, please remember to give your name and address and speak into the microphone. There is a time limit of 4 minutes. First we have on the list is Mr. Don Bailey. Mr. Bailey.
Don Bailey, Moss Corner, South Carolina. First thing I want to do is thank members of council for having the courage to do what you believe is the right thing. So that was the first thing that I wanted to do tonight, because I know that that's a very difficult thing to do. But you did it, and congratulations. The other issue deals with the First Amendment, and it deals when people such as myself come up here to speak. And when you look at reorganizing council or council rules, in the past, people come up and they sign up, and maybe have four or five other people that are with them. And maybe one person doesn't use all their time, or doesn't use their time at all. They surrender to someone else. I would like to see council be able to pass that on to the next party coming up. I think that's important, that if someone signs up to speak and they have someone who's coming up behind them and they want to surrender that time to them, give them that time. That's their time to speak. The other issue that I'm very concerned about was at the last meeting of the county council, you ran a video and an audio, and then the video disappeared. This was during the time of a passionate debate which occurred, and the folks at home could not witness that. Well, they want to see that. They want to see what goes on in their county council. My recommendation is this: when that gavel hits, that audio recorder comes on, that video recorder comes on, and it stays on until county council adjourns. That way, the citizens, there's no questions asked about what went on. The citizen sees and hears everything. And that's something that I would like for y'all to consider when you reorganize council and the rules of council. And that's all that I have. Thank you for this time.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Bailey. Next we have, I think it's Mr. Paul Forbes. Am I correct, Paula? Paul, excuse me.
Good evening, y'all. I'm Paula Forbes from Hugie, the 29450 zip code. We have the Dunmar Mines issue going back before we've been here in front of y'all. And now it's come back up again that they're at zoning, wanting to appeal for a bigger mine. And we don't have the emergency services or the infrastructure to support this. I mean, we just don't. We don't have water. We still have our wells. I've asked USGS and a couple of other, Emory University, to do a health study. I've also asked that we have a study done on United. They hit our water table. That was my first one. I'd like to bring it back up. That meeting's next week, and we need people to come and be aware that that mine is still trying to grow. I want progress as much as everybody else. We all do. But those people, there's a deed owner there who has had that deed in his family for that land since 1876. That means something. We can't mess up the water for those people. We really can't. I have a concern that it's a food desert in that area. You all know I teach farming for USDA and Native American medicine. We're giving away food, tons of food, every 2 weeks, every other Wednesday on Clements Ferry Road. We service 200 to 300 families every Wednesday. I'll be there tomorrow. It's the corner of Jack Primus and Clements Ferry Road. Thanksgiving's coming up, and a lot of these homebound people, I take that food that we have that they can't get to us, I take it to them. We need to be looking at a way to create a food pantry somewhere in 29450. If funding's a problem, I'll find you the money.
So moved.
Sir?
So moved. Find us some money.
Oh, I don't have a problem finding money.
I think you'll be with the new CBDG grant we have in place, sound like something very feasible.
It's not complicated. We just need to get it done.
I agree.
We can't build more out there until we can support what we are getting now. I mean, we've got people, and we're not helping them. That's all I have for y'all. Oh, I want to invite everyone on the 18th at Frybread Park. We're having an Indigenous Thanksgiving, and it includes everybody for the Wando, Cane Hoy, Hugie area.
Nice.
What time?
It's at 1 o'clock till 6 o'clock. We've got a bunch of speakers.
Okay.
We have satellite images of all of these dirt mines and the effect it's having on these communities. We ain't asking for a lot. We just want to slow it down a little bit until we can catch up, until you can catch up. Y'all have a good night.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Next, we have Michael Lewis.
Thank you. Oh, there he is.
Chairman, Council, appreciate you giving me this time to talk. I'd like to thank God for giving me breath and this country for giving me this right to speak. I'm not here to celebrate what's went down tonight. I support it 100%, and I appreciate y'all standing up for the voters and taking action for something I think was long coming and needed to be done. I gave over 26 years to this county, and I got over 31 years of public service. And I gave my heart to this county, and probably would have gave my soul if I didn't already give it to Jesus. And I was hurt over a lot that happened to me. I was born in Mount's Corner. I lived in Berkeley County all my life. And most people know that Berkeley County employees were like family to me, and I miss them dearly. I teach my kids honor, integrity, dignity. And y'all know things that was said about me, a lot of lies. In America, you're supposed to be able to face your accuser. I never was. I had some council members that said they couldn't talk to me because there was an investigation. There never was one. It's 2 years later. All the stuff that was said about me can be proven a lie, but I was never given a chance to defend myself. But I moved on. I got faith. I got support of my family. And I'm a winner. I don't lose. No matter what happened to me, I just want everybody in Berkeley County to know I support Berkeley County and employees, and I appreciate everything they did for me. But I will say this, one person I felt gave me support and believed in me and knew that stuff that was being said was a lie, and it was the sheriff. And I appreciate the sheriff, and he'll always have my vote. That's a man of integrity. I just thank y'all for your time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Next, we have our agenda items. First on the agenda is the termination of deputy supervisor, effective immediately. We have a motion.
So moved. Better be, make sure it's Tim Callan there now.
Yeah.
Make sure it's not.
Second.
Second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries.
Reflect me as excused, please, okay?
Okay. Steve's excused.
Yes.
Item
Dan,
two.
Thank you.
Item two is authorization.
In the newspapers, I was not here.
Item two is authorization to sleek sled investigation of misappropriation of funds. You have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
You have a motion. Any discussion on that item? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Item three was the forensic audit.
Hold that.
As I understand, we'll be holding that. Next, we got a freeze on supervisor's authority to expend any county funds.
Mr. Chairman, I move to freeze the supervisor's authority to supervise the expenditure of any funds not appropriated by council, no matter the level of the expenditure.
Do we have a second on that motion?
Second.
We have a second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Mr. Chairman, I move to amend the agenda for the same purposes of exigent circumstances to seek civil counsel regarding injunctive relief. So I move to amend the agenda at this time.
And that would be your motion also?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We have a second. Any discussion on that motion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries.
And Mr. Chairman, I would now move to authorize the county attorney to hire civil counsel to seek injunctive release as stated in committee.
Do we have a second on that?
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries, and I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
We have a motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We're adjourned. Thank y'all.
Thank y'all.
These are live. Yeah, I'll meet you. Hey, Jim.
Oh, hell.
Well, we'll see. Brenda Renz will not allow me to talk to any music.